Hello. Today I'm going to talk about what inspired Maharshi Valmiki to compose the great epic of Ramayana. Now for this, I need to take you 3000 years back. Because, you know, in those days there were not well-formed roads. Everybody had to pass through the forest and, you know, to reach from one place to another. Why I told this is, my grandson, when I narrate these stories, first thing he asks is, why people start going into the forest? Why they are not going on the road? So that is the reason. So we have to take the time context in, you know, into consideration. So there was a bird hunter or an ordinary hunter called as Prachetasa. Now this Prachetasa used to kill the animals and feed his people, but that was not enough. They needed some money also, some belongings also. So then he turned into a small-time dacoit. He started looting people. And when they were, you know, then he started killing people also. So this was his complete routine. So he would, you know, hunt animals and he would kill people and, you know, he would rob them and then go home and live a life. So that he was content with his own life with no intellect, nothing, just living a base life. One day what happens is he meets a Bharadwaja Rishi, who was, you know, passing through that forest. He did not have anything to lose, this Bharadwaja Rishi. So, like, he gets very, very surprised when Rishi is not scared at all when he goes to kill him. Then he says, on the contrary, instead of getting scared, Bharadwaja Rishi says, talks to him, why are you getting and indulging into these kind of acts? This is a heinous crime, killing another life. Why are you killing human beings? Why are you killing animals? Then this one hunter says, what do you expect me to do? I have to feed my family. Then he says, whatever act you are doing, you are accumulating a lot of sin. Are you aware of that? He says, no. You are accumulating a lot of sin. And remember one thing, whatever karmas you do, whatever sins you accumulate, you have to suffer it alone. Nobody will partake. Your family members are not going to be part of this. He says, how can you say that? My wife loves me so much. My parents love me so much. My children are there. I am doing it for them. So everybody will share my sins. Then Rishi says, all right, I am going to stay here only. You go and check and come back. Then tell me, what do they say? Now he was a little apprehensive, you know, like this Vyadha or a hunter. So he quickly goes home and he talks to his wife. He calls her. He asks her, like, you know, I met one Rishi and he is telling that I am committing a crime and this is a sin and I am sure you will be with me in this sin. She says, why are you asking this question to me after so many years? You have never asked me this. Look here, you have married me and you have given me children and you have to take care of your parents. So we all are not questioning how you are getting the stuff. It is your duty. So whatever you do is your karma. We cannot be partaking that sin, she says. Then there was a moment of transformation. You know, then he feels so bad. He rushes back to the Rishi and he says, like, you know, what do I do? Nobody is willing to share. But, you know, again, it is said, Kanaka Sangatam Rajatam Kanakam Bhavet. It means if you keep gold for a long time along with silver also will, some gold particles will rub into silver. The meaning or the purport is, if you are in good company or with people who are really good and virtuous, that virtues will start seeping into you. Same thing happened with this hunter, you know. So he advises Prachetasa, ki go and meditate and cleanse your karma. You can do it, like, you know, right from this moment, you can sit and meditate and seek God, seek the truth, and wash away your karmas. And so his journey begins, and every one of us know he does a lot of tapascharya. And why he was called Valmika, how Prachetasa became Valmika, Valmiki. Valmika means the ant hill, or where the snakes reside. Actually, they are, you know, that is made by the ants. So that developed around his entire body, but he was oblivious, he was not unaware of it. Only passers-by in the forest would only listen to the chants and Omkara and, you know, the God's names and chanting was heard. So that much he got engrossed. And one fine day, he got that knowledge, you know, like, then he came out. And then he became a complete transformed person. So a hunter who was a threat to people or passersby, who used to kill, who used to hunt, is now a completely transformed sage who is only focused on helping people and doing good to them. And he built a hermitage or ashram, and he started staying. He started caring for the animals and caring for the. That's how the story continues. But he was living a happy life, you know. Ramayana was nowhere in the picture there. Then one day what happened is his ashrama was on the bank of a river called as Tamasa Nadi or River Tamasa. So morning rituals, the Rishi went there and, you know, he was taking bath and he was returning. So when he was coming down, suddenly in front of him, a male stork fell down dead from the branch of a tree. Now, this stork is called as Krauncha in, Sanskrit. So, it is actually a small bird which has a round neck and a thick beak and then, you know, long legs and long beak and a plump body. So, it fell down. And actually, this bird was accompanied by another female bird and they were in fact mating. So it means why it fell dead, somebody must have killed it. So he looked around and then he looked at the female bird. It was wailing and crying and crying. See, every soul has certain yearnings and certain understanding. So they may not speak our language, but definitely they express their emotions. So Valmiki's heart melted, because Valmiki was now a completely a transformed person. His heart was only filled with love and compassion and nothing else. And he started really feeling very bad. And then when he looked around for the hunter, and he was absolutely furious with the hunter. He felt so bad. Why did he kill? You know, then suddenly, without awareness, see, this is what happens when your heart is transformed, when you're compassionate and you start feeling for others' pain. Okay. So man, these words came out of his mouth. Manishada pratishtham swamagamaha shashvatihi samaha yat krauncha mithuna dekam avadhi kama mohitam. So this was a kind of shloka that came out. This shloka had 32 syllables and it was set in a proper meter called as Anushtup Chanda, and it was very poetic. And actually, tears were rolling down his eyes, Valmiki's eyes, when he spoke this. And then, you know, what happened? When he said the meaning of this shloka, he said, hunter, like, you know, Vyadha or a Nishada or a Vyadha, you have no right to live. What a crime you have committed when two birds were mating. You killed that. It means that is the height of emotion. He started feeling for the birds and he cursed. Then suddenly he started repenting. Oh my God, what did I do? I was also a bird hunter. I was also a hunter. I have killed humans. I have killed the birds. And half of my life has gone into this. Today I am a sage. But how did I actually curse this Vyadha? In those days, the words were very powerful. Not like today, because they had their tapas siddhi. Whatever they said would come true. Then he started repenting. I shouldn't have said this. This is completely wrong. If I did it, like, you know, if I punished a human life, telling him to die or, you know, not to live, what did I do? Like, you know, for a bird's life, I claimed another human's life. Then what is the difference between me and Vyadha? What kind of a Rishi I am? What kind of Valmiki Rishi I am? So he started literally crying after that. You know, he felt very bad. At that time, you know, like he kept on saying to himself, Kimidam Vyahritam Maya, what did I do? What did I do? Now looking at his repentance and wailing, Brahma appeared and he pacified Valmiki. He said, don't worry, your heart is as pure as gold. You are completely a transformed person now. Whatever has come out is because of the feelings you developed for that female bird, and that is a flow of compassion. There is nothing wrong in that. You know, right now, what I feel is you have to start writing a story of Rama. So he says, Kuru Rama Katham Punyaha Shloka Baddaha Manoramaha. So he says, you must write the story of Sri Ramachandra Prabhu, who is an exemplary avatar of God in the form of human being. And this story is not just going to be writing anything. It will be a beacon of light for the entire generations to come. Okay, so you write this story, and he says, when your heart is melted for others' compassion, the words what came out without your awareness are so poetic. And now, you know, with this paripakva heart, ripe heart, now you are in a position, or you are the best fit person to write Ramayana. That is how he blesses him. And then, you know, Maharshi Valmiki also remembered his conversation with Maharshi Narad when he was one of his, you know, visits to his ashrama. He also had discussed Ramayana with him and Ram's story with him. So it was a complete intellectual exchange of knowledge in those days, and all the spirituality. They were all seekers of truth, seekers of the purpose of their life. So then he says, all right, I will write. Then Brahma blesses him. See, you will become a Adikavi. Adikavi means the first of your kind of a poet. Now, actually, if I say Valmiki wrote Ramayana, it is actually wrong, because in those days it was not writing. Writing was done much later by the scholars. It was all oral tradition at that time. So Rishi composed this. And these compositions were taught to the younger generations and to others. So it was all pure composition. And later on, they started writing it on the palm leaves. And later on, they, you know, when paper was invented, it got converted and all that. And Ramayana is one such story which is completely, you know, evergreen, I would say, in today's language. It can give us all the guidance if you want to take from it. Again, it is up to us. If you go to a, you know, Ganges River or Ganga Nadi, there's so much of pure water flowing, okay? And how much you want to drink, what you want to drink, it's up to you. So you, it's like an ocean. Knowledge is like ocean. So only what you can absorb, you can, you have to decide in that. So actually, you know, there is also a reference that one day Parvati asked Shiva, Lord Shiva, that please narrate the story of Ramayana. I'm interested in listening to that, you know, Vishnu's avatara. So Shiva actually narrated the entire story to Parvati, it seems. And Parvati was all ears, her body, like, you know, she sat with rapt attention and listened to the story. That is a powerful message we can get in Ramayana. So it's all up to us how we want to say it. So this was actually the inspiration for Maharshi Valmiki to compose great epic Ramayana. Thank you very much. If you like, share, you can share the video and subscribe to my channel. Thank you. God bless.